maybe the most talked about team and maybe the most impactful team in PSU history. You know, as a fundraiser, I go out and I talk to people who have been involved with Portland State for a long time, and it's not weekly, it might be, if not daily, it's definitely weekly that I hear stories about the fans that supported this team, about how many people started their engagement with PSU through this team. And so it's so exciting and definitely well deserved that we're now inducting this team. The Division II era of Portland State football peaked during the 1987 and 88 seasons when Pokey Allen led the Vikings and reached the Division II national championship game each season. The Vikings were combined 22-5-2 those two seasons and had a perfect 6-0 record in the Western Football Conference. The Vikings matching 11 win seasons ranked as the most wins ever at PSU and came in back-to-back seasons. Moreover, the Vikings captured the attention of the city of Portland and the media in the stands. PSU drew over 10,000 fans to games on 8 occasions and 21,000 fans to a national semifinal win over Texas A&I in 1988. Portland State averaged over 10,000 fans each season for the first time in 1988. Those Vikings teams were dominant offensively and defensively, earning a total of 20 first-team All-WFC honors, as well as Coach of the Year twice for Pokey Allen, and Offensive Player of the Year Chris Crawford in 1987 and Critters Delgado in 1988, and Defensive Player of the Year for Tracy Eaton in 87 and Kevin Wolfolk in 88. We're fortunate that we have, I want to say, around 50 of these gentlemen here tonight. And we're going to have a few speakers to come and speak on behalf of the team. So before I induct them, I'd like to invite Coach Mason, who was on the staff as the defensive coordinator for Pokey Allen at the time.
Well, they told me I got 3 minutes, so we know it's going to last a lot longer than that. So we'll get started here. But it's really truly an honor to be here. I drove down. I'm living in Coeur d'Alene, Idaho right now, and I'm in between jobs. They gave me an opportunity to seek employment elsewhere at the University of Texas, El Paso, last year. So I moved on, and I'm going to be moving into another job that'll start the end of December. So driving in, I was coming in with my wife, and you know, Portland and Portland State are truly a unique situation that until you're away from it, you really forget how great it was here. This team, to me, excited a city. We come in here, first year we're 6-5, we say, yeah, you guys are pretty good, you know, all that bullshit. And then all of a sudden, the next year, we're playing for the national championship, and this city got behind us. I look at guys like Jerry Nudelman. He was raising money for us. Larry Herman's, Cap Hedges, those Nike commercials. Pokey, he's riding a damn elephant, lighting himself on fire. I mean, the city went nuts, and that was what it was all about. You know, that was truly Portland. And one of the things I'll say about this team is this team had great team chemistry. I've been coaching now, I'm going on 40 years of coaching. The great teams that we had great chemistry. And these two teams were as good a chemistry as any teams we've ever had. And, you know, that says a lot for the players. We'd get in a damn bus, we'd go practice, it didn't matter where. Civic Stadium, if that was full, we'd go find a park. If that was full, we went down, you know, towards Vancouver and those parks down there. We just go out and practice, and that's what we did, and nobody said anything, nobody cared, and we just got after it. And that was the personality or the trait of this ball club. I wrote a bunch of notes here. I don't need these notes. You know, and I really, truly wish Pokey Allen was here to accept this. I'm one of the greatest college coaches of all times. I've been around a lot of college coaches, and there was none better. And I think about some of the things that, you know, Pokey did, and just a few things, and I know a lot of the team will remember what we're talking about here. He always used to say when something would go wrong, Mace, what's he thinking? And I'm like, how the hell am I supposed to know what he's thinking? And then he would say, "Mace, get that guy under control." And everybody said his teams had no discipline. His teams had great discipline. Those kids did exactly what Pokey wanted done all the time. He just had a unique way of doing it. And his way of doing it was, "Hey, if it wasn't fun, gang, let's not do it." How many times did you guys hear that? "If it ain't fun, gang, let's not do it." So, you know, I would just wish he was here today. He'd be so proud of you guys. It would, you know, it would really be something to see him. You know, I look at some of the great moments. We're driving, coming back from South Dakota last weekend. We drive by Grizzly Stadium in Missoula there. And I'm thinking it's late, 1987, it's late in the fourth quarter. The Grizz are driving down. We run Robert Tom cover two. You guys remember that? Yeah, Tracy Eaton hits the quarterback. Ball bounces up in the air. Kurt Simmons picks it off and runs it to the length of the field to score a touchdown to win that game. Yeah, and Simmons couldn't run. I don't know how the hell he got there. You know, so a couple of the other things that really come to mind is the pass with Crawford to Corrigan late in the game against Jacksonville State. We're going to get beat. We're in the semifinals, or it's a game before the or I guess it was the quarterfinals, and Crawford throws the ball. I thought it was scissors and razors, but Corrigan said it was all go. And Corrigan catches it. We win that game, and the city goes nuts. So we got one more playoff game to go to the national championship that year, and then we end up doing it. And then throughout my coaching career, I still talk about this place, Scott Talby. We're playing Texas A&M Kingsville. It was old Texas A&I back then. And we're getting late in the game, and they got, I think, 9 NFL draftees on that team, but he's had a backfield of Johnny Bailey and Heath Sherman. And they come down with a triple option. And I'm standing on the sidelines, and they pitch the ball to Johnny Bailey, and it's Johnny Bailey and Scott Talby one-on-one in the open field. And I'm thinking, oh, shit, we're going to go recruiting. Talby makes the play. We win. We go to the national championship game. So those are just a few of the exciting times that we had with that team. The other thing I wanted to recognize the coaching staff. I know a lot of guys are still coaching. I know Oz is here. Stand up, Oz. Al Borges, Dave Stromswald, Barry Sachs, Ole, Grip, you're here somewhere. Stand up, Grip. That was really, truly one of the amazing coaching staffs I've ever been on. We went 9 years, and that's unheard of in this business, without a coaching change. And that just tells you what a great man Pokey Allen was. None of us wanted to leave. He was too easy to work for. And we just kept winning. We won 78% of our games with Pokey Allen as a coach. I'm going to finish up now. The thing that's great about these teams, and what was unique about these two teams or these 2 years, it wasn't the great athletes. It was the great people that were on these teams. And you can see it today, the guys that have been successful. And you watch these, you look at these kids today, we'd be so proud of you guys. And you were just little snot-nosed 18, 19-year-old kids back then. And look what you've become today. You know, I'm really proud, John, that you got in the Hall of Fame. You're a great quarterback, okay? Really great quarterback. And I know I'm only supposed to talk 3 minutes, so I'm going to get off right now.
You can talk for as long as you want, as long as you finish that way, and you keep everybody's attention the whole way. So, all right, we have two more speakers on behalf of the team. I'd like to invite Barry Naoni to the stage. He was a tight end, and Barry is already an individual member of the Hall of Fame. He was inducted in the 2008 class.
Wow. Yeah, I got to tell this story. Mace was never that good in front of the camera, ever. I was just telling Tracy, I got to follow that. Holy crap. First off, I want to thank the administration and the athletic department for honoring us. It's fantastic. Mace stole a little bit of my thunder. I wanted to recognize some of the coaches that aren't here. Offensively, I'm up here representing the offense. Coach Borges, Coach Stroms, Coach Oz is here. Coach Papa Giorgio, Steve Mick, he was a player, he's a coach. And Andy Ludwig, for sure. Lud was a coach that we had as well. Also here is TJ Byrne, who is our athletic trainer. He's up for a medical conference. TJ was the man. I think one of the other things that I've been fortunate enough to be inducted into the Hall of Fame individually, and to my brothers on the team, I am more proud of this than I am of that, and I'm truly honored to be here representing all of you. It's a true pales in comparison. I wanted to talk a little bit about you can't tell offensively, it's a bit of a microcosm of the team as a whole, but there's a story of three that I have. The first year that Pokey and Coach Mace and the team came, we were off of a pretty down year. I think we were 3-8. Coaching staff left. A lot of us were sort of, what does that mean, right? And we had this young coaching staff come in, led by this guy named Pokey. And all we knew was that they rented this house in downtown Portland somewhere. They were all sleeping on mattresses and couches, and you know, that was our new coaching staff. And it was difficult in that there were some of us that Coach Reed and that staff brought in, and really it was all about just, okay, what is this new coaching staff gonna do? How are we gonna perform? And we grinded it out. We ended up, I think, 6-5. Had a good year. It wasn't a bad year. Had a good year, and we did pretty well. Coming out of that, coaching staff brought in some new recruits. They brought in Naprakowski. They brought in Spears. They brought in Ina, Ace Salu. They brought in these monsters on the defensive side of the ball, and we had obviously the guys that Don Reed had brought in, and we're getting better. But they brought in this new crop of players. Offensively, you know, Crawford, Corrigan, Evers, like, you know, we had Bill Duard and Frank Mayo, and we brought in Rick Allender from JC. Howard Hoyle was still there, and we were like, all right, we got this new team, and we didn't know how good we were going to be, right? We loved the coaching staff, we loved the energy they brought, but we weren't really sure how good we were going to be. So we're feeling optimistic, and we played Wisconsin Stevens Point, which is an NAIA school, and we did okay. I think we beat them pretty easily, but there was still that question mark. And we got on the road to Montana. And as Coach mentioned, what he did mention was they were opening the new stadium. It was the first game they were playing in their new stadium. And you know, they had a bunch of NFL prospects that were there, and we just roll up and we just smacked ass. I mean, 20-3. And what Mace didn't say, and maybe that's what I heard Simmons yell, maybe the slowest return for a touchdown I've ever seen. Possibly. Right, Sims? So, and from there, it was like, all right, like, we were gaining confidence, and you know, Borge was doing what he was doing, and Mace was doing what he was doing. And the great thing about Coach Allen was, you know, I agree with Mace, and we talk about it all the time. He let his coaches coach. You know, that's what good leaders do, right? They empower their teams, and they let their coaches do their thing. And we roll up, we go, end up going to the playoffs. Mankato State, the infamous Mankato State game. Scotty LaBoy came in from Hawaii, the Mankato State monster, stripping that guy in the end zone. Not a catch. And we go on, and we get to the national championship. Right, fantastic year. Didn't end up winning, but you know, it was great. We're going to the third year, and like, we were the shit. Like, we thought we were the shit coming in. And you know, we were cocky, man. We were so cocky. And the coaching staff, when we would play hoops in the summer, coaches would tell us, "You guys ain't that good. You're not that good," but we weren't listening. So we started out rough. 1-2-1. We started out. And I never forget this, and we talk about it all the time. Pokey came in and tore us up one side and down the other, halftime of Indiana PA. And, you know, it was like, all right, boys, here we go. From that half on, didn't lose another game. We played A&I twice, right? A&I twice, powerhouse, end up North Alabama. End up playing for the championship game. Again, not winning, but it was a great ride. What I think most, and again, I'm representing the offense, but I think about us as a team. I think of three things. I think of our coaching staff and the confidence and the faith they had in us and the vision they had of greatness. And it was all about being as good as you can be, leading us, trusting us, empowering us to be that team. I think about how hard we worked, and we busted our ass. I mean, there was no team that worked harder than we did. And we weren't the biggest, we weren't the fastest. Smurf, I know he's not here, but he was probably one of the fastest guys on the team. But we were not a fast team. But we worked our asses off. And we worked hard. And we trusted each other. And we kept each other honest. And we had each other's back. And that's what great teams do. And to this day, when I think back of all the athletic experiences that I've had, this is the one I think of. Because at the end of the day, we knew where we wanted to go. We knew what we needed to do to get there, and we went out and did it. And the best part about this team, and you've seen it as we've walked around, you see it in Mace and what he says, you see it in the way we interacted when we were playing, we had a blast every single day. Practice, game, warm-ups, walkthroughs, you name it, we had a blast. And I think, and I'll just sum up all of this, and Mace said it, Pokey was a man before his time. You see all these coaches these days making the millions of dollars that they make. Pokey left Berkeley. He was a defensive coach, came up, was coaching the Breakers, and then he took a chance on this small little school in Oregon. And he took our team in 2 years to a national championship, two in a row, did the same thing at Boise, and God rest his soul, he passed away. But it was all about Pokey and what he did and how he empowered us. And a lot of credit obviously goes to him and the staff that he brought. But I'll just sum up and say that to my brothers from the 87, 88 team, thank you, and we're in.
And our last speaker of the evening is Tracy Eaton. He was a defensive back for the Vikings, and he went on to be drafted by the Houston Oilers and played for the Atlanta Falcons as well. And he's also a member of the Hall of Fame and drafted, or he was put in the Vikings Hall of Fame, I believe, in 2008. So Tracy Eaton, everybody.
Thank you, man. What some great talks, great athletes, love being around champions. There's just something about being around champions, isn't there? That community where, you know, people are persevering and people are getting coached and mentored. And man, oh man, am I thankful for you guys. Thank you to you guys putting this on. This is just an amazing, what you're doing is amazing. Thank you for recognizing all of us. And, you know, my gosh, Mason, so good to see you, my man. Oh, my gosh. I just love getting back. It's like I feel like playing again, you know. It's one of those things. I got one kickoff left in me. That's what I always tell people. I'm going to be blown apart, but I got one left in me. And I just want to honor all you guys that I played with. I would not be where I'm at, where I went without you guys. Without that winner and those champions, there is no possible way. I got to play 6 years in the NFL. I got drafted by the Houston Oilers. And, you know, I just, I remember coming from Portland State University, a Division II school, going to Houston. By the way, in July and August, a little warm. You know what I mean? It's like, well, I thought I went to hell. I swear to you. I mean, everybody thinks it's just a joy and it'll be perfect, but there was nothing like the college days. It became business. It really did. And I'm there sitting in 100-degree weather in training camp, and my defensive backs coach name was Nick Saban, and that's one letter off from how I felt about him. I was just dreaming about Pokey. But bring him back to me, please. Because Nick Saban and I don't know. Maybe he didn't like me. I don't think he really likes anybody. But I remember going, and it was old school back then. You know, it was late 80s, and I remember doing some jumping jacks to warm up for about 5 minutes. And my coach Jerry Glanville, and I know Mouse Davis is in the room here. My coach, Jerry Glanville, goes, all right, time to hit, guys. We're going to do goal line tackling drills. And I remember going out there for that first practice, going, I'm a Division II football player. I am this little boy from Medford. I have a body that looks like a bowler. They probably use my image in bowling trophies. My body wasn't meant to play this game, and I'm lined up. I'm sitting on the goal line, and the running back has got to be going right, has got to score, right? And they put some cones down, and it was a guy named Alonzo Highsmith. And I don't know, you guys, you know, my age, you know who Alonzo Highsmith. Alonzo Highsmith's thighs were this big. If you Google him right now, it will show him when he went into his boxing career. The guy's a monster. So I'm up there, shaking, scared, totally out of place. And Alonzo runs me over like I was just nothing. And I started to walk back to the end of the line. And you know what I thought about? I thought about Pokey and Mason and Rick Olson. I thought about the players I was playing with and representing Portland State University, a Division II school, a David and Goliath story. And I thought about, I'm not getting back in that line. And I stepped right back on top of that line, and I told Alonzo, I said, Alonzo, one more time, because I knew I was only there one time. I was only there one time. And here is my shot. I took him down. Oh, I went a little lower this time. You know, and I just look back at those moments of going that extra mile and where that came from. And it came from my tenure at Portland State University. It really did. It really did. You know, having those losing seasons at the beginning in our career, it built some kind of, it built up a callus where we're like, well, it's not going to be like this when we're seniors. It's not going to be like this. And to be able to go out there and you know, live the life that we were able to live. And, you know, I've tackled Bo Jackson. Actually, he tripped over me, but it counts as a tackle. You know, intercepting balls from Rodney Peete and Jim McMahon and Steve Berline and Jim Kelly in a playoff game. And going, you know, this little Division II guy that got a start in Portland State University, they decided to give him a look. And all because we won. And if we didn't win, I would have never been noticed. So I want to thank you, and I'm honored by you, because I got to live a life because of you guys deciding to go out there and play as a team, and our coaches of Pokey and Mason and all those guys bringing together a team that is just so phenomenal. And that it was such a crazy team. If you know, and there's a lot of you out here. I see the Van Velardis in the room, and these, you know, these, all these, it was like a cartoon, to be honest with you. I mean, we have Beakers. We, you know, there was our kicker. We have Smurfs. And, you know, and I actually talked to him. I was at the Seahawk game this last weekend, and he wrote me about a 10-minute speech that he wanted me to tell you guys. And so I'll just give you the synopsis. He loves you, and that's good. But we had, you know, Chris Crawford at the helm. You know, he's like a Yosemite Sam, for crying out loud. He's just, and what a champion he was. We all wanted to kill him, but he made us all better. because, you know what, his confidence and his strength. And I knew through Chris and Tim Corrigan, I knew that something was going to happen through all the players that we had in Smurf, that the defense was going to make a play. And even if the quarterback threw the ball in the wrong hands like they did to Kevin Wolfolk, one time I saw Kevin Wolfolk intercept a ball. I saw him take 12 steps, and he only went a foot. It's amazing. Couldn't believe my eyes. And guys like Joe Rogers that I played with, that he's got some record in interceptions. I was the free safety. I got no interceptions. I wanted nothing to do with the ball. I just wanted to hit people. You know, that's what I just wanted. That's all I like to do. And I remember being back there as a defensive back, and everybody's guarded, and the quarterback throwing the ball. I'm like, where the hell is he throwing the ball? And it was always to Joe, the wrong guy. And then Joe would run around like Curly on the Three Stooges, you know, and trying to get a few yards. And, you know, and just to bring, you know, what we had together, where we were in that time. And I want to let you guys know, I don't want to take too long, but I want to let you guys know, everything you did, everything that you were in that period of time, you can use that in your life. And I just pray, I pray that your future is brighter than your past. This is something that is so honorable, and you should be honored. But I pray your future is brighter, that you take those things and remember the power of being coached and under mentorship, that you take those things and remember that we went early and we stayed late. We had a common vision together. Just remember that we had a community that we wanted to win, and we brought all kinds of people together that generally should never be together, and the world tries to tear us apart in the news and all the garbage that's going on. But we came together because we had a more common vision of moving forward and winning together. And if we can get that in this room, we can go change the world together. And I'm not going to make a political speech. I'm not running for president, by the way. But I want you guys all to know that you have excellence in you. And don't let mediocrity take over. There's still a bright future for you. Thank you for everybody. Thank you for everybody here that came in to support this. All the other inductees, I am so, so happy for you. And you know what? You deserve it. You worked your butt off for that. And never forget what got you there. Okay? Thank you.
I have a few last things to say, but I'm after we induct this class, so everybody stick around. But it is now my honor to induct the 1987-1988 National Runner-Up Football Teams into the 2018 class of the Viking Athletics Hall of Fame. So everybody give them a round of applause. Now, everybody come on up. We tested, this can hold 10,000 pounds. This can hold 10,000 pounds. So everybody, come on up, guys. We're going to get a photo with you guys, and everybody's going to get your trophies.
Thank you.
top. Cameras up top. Got a few guys left. Cameras up top. Check, 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 check. All right, everybody. Check, 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 check. All right, count of three, everybody. Count of three. We're going to get a photo. Count of three. The camera's up top. Camera's up top. Count of three. One, two, three. All right, we got it. We got it. Congratulations again to the 2018 Hall of Fame class. This is the 1987-88 teams. Nice job, everybody. I think we got it. We got it. We got it. Let's go this way.